Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Hearthstone Championship Tour, America's Spring Preliminary. Over 100 players have gathered at fireside gathering locations across North and South America to battle it out against other players in their region for 8 spots at the Spring Championship. My name is TJ, and joining me on the desk for the first matchup is the cheekiest lad in all the land. It's Soddle. Soddle, how are you doing this morning?
I'm doing great. I will do my best to live up to that intro and max out my cheeky levels for this weekend, but thank you. Happy to be here.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. And of course, joining us for the first time on the Hearthstone Championship Tour desk, it's HX9, a.k.a. Bob. Bob, how are you enjoying so far this casting experience, and are you excited for today?
Well, it's been an exciting weekend, and I'm looking forward to seeing all these great Hearthstone players play today.
Yeah, it should be an exciting weekend. Of course, if you're unfamiliar, if this is your first time tuning in to the Hearthstone Championship Tour, we'll give you a little bit of an idea of how the format works. Players have qualified for these preliminaries by earning Hearthstone Championship Tour points. They're either ranked play or online cups. Also, there are 32 players participating in the preliminary that won their local Tavern Hero events at their Fireside Gatherings.
Yes, indeed. And then we take all those players that have met those qualification conditions and put them into one giant double elimination bracket, 100-plus players, as TJ mentioned. We play that through until the top 8, and then your top 8 players this weekend will go forward to America's Spring Championship.
Now, those players are playing from 22 different locations across all of the Americas. Players could be playing against players in Brazil from Chicago. Players in California could be playing against people in Canada. People from Canada actually traveled to North America, to the Seattle Play Center up there. All sorts of places around here that anyone could be playing from right now.
Yeah, there's a lot of players participating. And for some of these players who have sort of earned their points from online play through either ranked player cups, this might be their first time competing in a live environment. This might be their first time, you know, being face-to-face with other players. And even though they might not be playing against the players at their venue, it's still an interesting experience. It's a really cool thing, and I'm looking forward to seeing what the weekend has in store for us. But, of course, with the new season, there comes some changes. If you tuned into the Europe preliminary last week, you know that we are using Standard for this season of the Hearthstone Championship Tour. And there's been a lot of changes with Standard. Why don't you go over some of those, Soddle?
Yeah, most of these things that you're looking at right now, with these cards were just kind of best in class or best in slot, just kind of optimal order options that kind of dictated everyone's deck building. So along with the new expansion, there are all these changes to the classic set cards just to open up deck building variation, to make deck building decisions more difficult. You know, changes to Silence was a really big deal. That's had a huge impact on the metagame going forward because Silence was extremely powerful before. This is just about a larger variety of options and less obvious deck building decisions.
And Bob, how have these changes to some of these cards and, of course, taking away some of the previous sets, how has this sort of changed the landscape of the tournament meta that we're in right now?
Well, nerfing a lot of the cards did open up a lot of options for players that they wouldn't normally use before. So Big Game Hunter and Druid, now replaced by Mulch in many cases. Things like Soulfire finding ways in the Zoo decks with the Knife Juggler nerf. There are lots of different changes.
Yeah, it's been completely different. We saw some players opting for safe choices in the Europe preliminary, but America's has, you know, a lot of big things. And, of course, we have Whispers of the Old Gods, the new set. Have the Old Gods made a big splash in the meta so far, Soddle?
They've made a huge splash. By definition, the gods all dictate this deck building style where you have to create a new archetype built around the god that you've chosen. So if you're playing Nazoth, you have to have a whole bunch of Death Rattles in your deck. So you're creating the, you know, Death Rattle Warlock, Death Rattle Rogue, Death Rattle Paladin. C'Thun, of course, you're dictated to have to play the Cultist. So the old gods have this effect where they just create new archetypes almost single-handedly.
Yeah. And Bob, what's been sort of your favorite archetype or your favorite deck that has come out from the Standard changes and, of course, Whispers of the Old Gods set?
You know, I've really enjoyed playing Renolock in the previous seasons. So now that you can add Nazoth, C'Thun to it and add all these different combinations of cards, it makes so many different varieties of Renolock, and that is absolutely my favorite archetype.
I'm looking forward to the day when every single old god is put into Renolock. It's only a matter of time before someone does it. But it should be an exciting weekend filled with Hearthstone action. But before we jump into the first match, we are going to send it over to Dan and the boys who are standing over at the prediction board.
Thank you very much, TJ and crew. That's right. I am Frodan, and I am joined by the handsome part of the talent team, Brian Kibler, Savitz, and Raven. And this portion, if you guys watched the Europe Spring Preliminary, is where we do our predictions of who will go to the top eight. Now, we do recognize that there's lots of players, especially ones that people have been following for a long time, but there's also a lot of players who are on the cusp of breaking out, and we want to introduce some of them to you. Let's go ahead and scour throughout the region, starting with the U.S. West. Kibler, you've been paying attention to this?
I mean, you see some big names who everyone will recognize, like Amaz here, as well as other players who may not be quite as well-known, but are also very successful, like Demigod or The Lucky One, who just recently topped the ranked season in April.
For U.S. Central, we have a lot of known pros. To name a few, Admirable, Jockey, Doc, and Tides of Time.
Yeah, it's one of the most stacked regions, and Raven, you've been looking at US East.
Yeah, the thing that sticks out most about East is that there's a lot of players such as Amnesiac, All Sky High, Chess Dude that are returning from good performances in the winter tournament.
Yeah, finalist Nostam as well, and even WTY Bill. Canada, of course, a country that is well-respected, although you don't really see too many of the players always in the event itself performing. Like in the championship, you still have players who are always threatening. They're on the verge of breakthrough. Hot Form, of course, making his return in the spring season. BlizzCon finalists, a lot of people looking for him to make waves.
And Latin America has always been kind of a dark horse region in Hearthstone. We have America's finalist Korea returning, as well as perennial contenders Kog'Lorian and Leomane among them.
Yeah, of course, Tavern Hale, Snail.
Yeah, absolutely.
We'll see if whether or not Snail can make that epic run once again like he did in the winter season. So those are the list of players. We know that there's a lot of names, and it's hard to follow everyone through the bracket. We highly encourage you guys to follow along with us as the day progresses, as well as going into tomorrow. But we also want to give some idea of who we like to follow for many different reasons. So as such, we have the prediction board, which is always really fun to follow. This week, Savitz and Bob have joined alongside us, and they're going to be making the predictions every single day. Choice was drafted, meaning that the selections were exclusive. If one person picked it, another caster was not able to choose it. And as such, we went through a snake. Savitz got first and last picks. So let's start off right away with Savitz's first pick, which won't surprise many people. It is Dog on Team Liquid as well. Savitz, go ahead.
Yeah, once I heard that I have the first pick, I didn't need to hesitate. Dog, not only my good friend and teammate, but also based on some community sites rankings, he's actually, based on recent results, he's the number one US player right now in the world. And not only that, he's known for his rogue deck, he's bringing that, but he's playing all four old cards across his four decks. How amazing is that?
Yeah, Dog's really picking up steam, not just in terms of how his stream is taken off, but also his results is finally catching up to how strong he is as a player. I think this is an excellent pick. I also think number two is a good pick here from Raven as well. I need to go to the gym more. All right, VLPS, a player that I've been hyping up for a long time. Why did you choose him so early on, though?
Yeah, I did actually want Dog initially, and I heard Savitz was getting the first pick, so that was kind of frustrating. I think we all thought that. But yeah, VLPS is just a really steady player. He's got creates really strong decks and just plays nothing too crazy, I don't think, but he plays very well and just plays strong decks. And I know for a fact that he's prepared quite extensively for this tournament.
Yeah, I wonder if the fact that he's traveling will impact him. I do believe he's playing in Canada when VLPS is from the greatest state in the U.S., New Jersey. Now, TJ is on the caster desk right now, and he did choose a good buddy, Nostam, a player that he's familiar with, also a player that he's been casting for a long time, not just in HCT, but also some of the other cups outside of it. Really justified pick, considering his performance in winter was very surprising.
Yeah, I mean, he got second place at the winter championship, so it's hard to really question a choice like that.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, going into questionable choices... Just kidding. Kibler chose Chalky.
Yeah, I mean, nothing really to say here. Chalky, he didn't have many wins or any wins for a while, and then won DreamHack Austin and the ONOG Championship back-to-back. So, you know, amazing results from him recently.
Absolutely. And just, you know, we talk about consistency. I think Chalky very much takes after a player like Tice. Sure, he's not winning everything, but you always see him appearing in the finals of an event, a top eight, maybe even getting to the finals. That was part of his moniker, that he always got second place. A very strong choice. In fact, some of the cast were like, oh, that's right, we wanted to pick Chalky too, even though some of these players on the board. Very good. Now, I'm going to go slightly left field for my first pick. I picked Just Saying, and immediately everyone's going to be like, well, of course, you're on Temple Storm, but Sand's been a player that's been helping a lot of other players have their breakout performance. People look at Super JJ's recent good performance. They look at Amnesiac. And both of them accredit Just Sand for being the reason why they won those tournaments. And for so long, you've been seeing players like Purple, for example, the America's champion from 2015. The reason why they're successful is because they've been having so much practice with some of these players, and they've been the reason why other players won. I think it's time for Just Sand to break out.
He also just had a very strong result in DreamHack Austin as well.
Yep, so. Yeah, that's right.
Doing very well in standard format already.
All right, now over to Sato, who's over at the desk, but he picked a player that's also on the same level as Just Sand, in my opinion. I think Muzzy's been on the verge of breaking out for a while.
Yeah, Muzzy has been extremely consistent in getting those points. Every single season for the spring, he has finished in the top 20, and that's something that no other player has accomplished.
Crazy. Yeah, you look at his points, and it's just you know, tons of points from every ranked play season. It's unbelievable consistency.
Yeah, I think he's very similar to Crane in that aspect, where like everyone knows he's fantastic at the game, but everyone's just waiting for that big performance in the tournament.
Absolutely, and he also plays this really cool, unique stuff. I've been seeing him play Priest all the time. Love to see some of that too for the preliminary. Now, Bob does get two picks as part of the snake draft. So the first one is another winter finalist for the championship. It is WTY Bill. And his second pick, Kip, I'm going to need you to help me here sometimes.
Right. You got it.
Good teamwork. Phone Tap. So these are two interesting picks. Do you want to break it down at all, Kip?
Yeah, Bob said they actually talked to WTY Bill, and Bill felt like he had a pretty disappointing result in the Winter Championship and really kind of redoubled his efforts to improve on that performance here.
Yeah, I mean, I love his lineup, too. He's bringing some very, very cool stuff. If you guys haven't got a chance to know, we posted all the decks publicly for all the players, so that way players on stream don't get a disadvantage at all. Bill's definitely a player to look out for with some of his interesting builds. And Phone Tap, too, he's bringing a Hunter. What do you guys think? I'm going to toss to you, Raven. What do you think about Hunter these days and why Phone Tap's bringing it?
Yeah, I think Hunter's actually sort of just come out of nowhere in the past like week or so even, maybe even that recent, where everyone thought it couldn't quite make it at the start because they're a lot more crazier things to mess with in deck choice, right? But Hunter's just got just really strong at the moment because people started playing things like Doomsayer just to negate the fact that it doesn't really have this strong early game it used to with the lack of Creeper. But the second it gets to turn 8 and you just play Call of the Wild, a lot of the time that just closes out some games.
Yeah. I think Hunter is a great pick. Not that many people are bringing it, and it's like Rockraven mentioned, it's only made an impact recent weeks or last week. Once Whispers of the Old Gods came out, not that many people had their eyes on Hunter at first, but I think it's a strong class to bring.
Absolutely, and that's exactly why Bob was picking it, too. He's like, oh, he's bringing Desert Camel and Hunter. Zombie Chow's kind of out of the set rotation, so maybe we'll see some movement there. Let's take a second look here at what Sato's pick is. Okay, we need to go to the gym, too.
I'm right-handed, man.
The Rat. All right, so this is a player that some people may have been hearing his name being whispered a few times at tournaments. What do you know about this pick? Of why Sato chose him?
The Rat, he's a very strong player. He dated back to, I believe it was actually the ESL Legendary Series 2 that Phone Tap won. The Rat was one of the players who qualified for that. He recently, I believe, actually lost to Chalky in the top 4 of the Onog event that Chalky ended up winning. So definitely a player on a lot of people's radar in terms of also looking for a big breakout performance.
Yeah, his first breakout performance in general was also his biggest infamous claim to fame, where he said, to his own decree, that he is the best patron player in the world. And I think he's learned a lot from that. You know, I think he's really taken that confidence, which has really helped him give the necessary fuel for motivation. But at the same time, I think he's ready to, you know, finally follow through with some of his claims. So I'm looking forward to see if he can do that. Now let's go to my second pick. This one, I was actually really torn between a few players. I really wanted to pick some of the guys that were up and coming as well. But I saw this name on the board, and I'm like, oh, I need to choose this. It's Tides of Time, a player that people have forgotten in recent times for being a really strong player in some of these formats. And I think Tides is ready to start claiming back his rightful throne on Americas, especially when he's motivated.
Yeah, I'm so excited to see Tides of Time play here. He's bringing that Yogg-Saron Shaman with Elemental Destructions. I have been playing it myself during the past few days, and it's quite an amazing deck both to play and to watch. And I think that it works very well, and he can go far.
It's super unique, and that's what I love when Tides is in this element of doing weird stuff, but also very good stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. And if he has any Yogg-Sarons like the one you showed me screenshots of this morning, he's going to go far.
We'll see. By the way, Tides is our first match up against Fibonacci. A really cool match that's going to be happening in just a few minutes when we wrap up these predictions. Kibler, go ahead and show us your second one.
All right, it is Zalae.
All right, very strong choice. Another person that I was debating at this point. Why Zelay?
Zelay is a player who's kind of been in the shadow of his teammates for quite a while. Originally, sort of Firebat Purple, both sort of outshone him. Now, Amnesiac just won the Winter Championship. Mm-hmm. And all these players also, you know, credit Zelay for helping them practice and prepare. So clearly someone who's going to be coming into this with a lot of practice under his belt.
Yeah, and I like that Zelay has also just been working hard. Like, last year, he was a number one point getter in 2015. So, and people have already kind of forgotten that because they're looking at people this year. Don't forget about these guys who've always been working hard and on the cusp of having that successful tournament. TJ's second pick, which is very much like TJ. Once again, you know, someone had to kind of fill Rob Wing's shoes this week. So, with Nostam and Yozflow, Nostam's a good choice, but Yozflow is definitely a little bit out there.
He is a player who is a part of the same practice group as Nostam and Chalky, and you know, they're bringing some pretty exciting decks. They actually posted a picture on social media this morning of all of them with eye patches, you know, for their Pirate Warrior Unity. So
I'm just waiting for that.
Exciting.
I'm just waiting for that deck to just be banned every single game.
I want to see some pirates. It's going to be an exciting weekend.
It's absurd. Some people are using it to climb top deck legend. I know Ignite, for example, who played in the Europe Spring Preliminary last week, got top 10, just went on an absolute rampage. It's like 80% win rate. Pirate Warriors on the map. And Yozflow brought the same exact lineup as Chalky 2 DreamHack and Chalky 1 DreamHack. So, well, definitely a pick that could do really well and surprise some people. I'm liking it, TJ. All right, let's wrap this up. Raven has his second pick, and this one is a player who broke out last season. You're expecting him to do the same thing for Springs?
Yeah, completely. I mean, this is a pretty straightforward pick as well. He performed exceptionally well at Winter, I think. As well as getting far, he actually just played very well in every single game. A little bit worried as he is a sort of a rogue master, and I know a lot of people are targeting rogue at the moment, but I think if anyone can do it, he can. So I'm really looking forward to seeing him play.
And Savitz, you're going to finish strong.
Just about.
That was even my right hand, too.
No excuses.
Yeah, this one was an easy pick for me. Amnesiac. He's the Winter Champion. He's coming back here. He's bringing a solid lineup of decks. We all know he can play. I wouldn't be surprised if he made it to top 8 once again and maybe even take it all down.
Cool.
We did see Naaman, you know, just sort of go 0-2 out. I don't know if the champions of the previous season have quite the same motivation as people who are really fighting for their spot to BlizzCon still, but we'll see.
It's true, though. Although Amnesiac did say that he wants to be a guy winning every single championship.
Right.
And I love that confidence, such a young player. And we'll see whether or not he's able to bring it. And what I mean, this is our predictions, and we just get a feeling of it, but it's supposed to be a mix of players who are known and unknown. We do left some notable players off, but I'm sure people will be following how Amaz goes through the tournament and other players like that, and some of your favorite players as well. Make sure to hashtag HCT and let us know your predictions. Join us in the social media conversation on twitter.com/playHearthstone or facebook.com/Hearthstone. And with that, I think we're ready for our first match of the day. It's Tides of Time versus Fibonacci. Can't wait to see how these two control players are going to match up against each other. Let's once again send it back over to TJ, Sottle, and Bob to get ready for our first series.
Thank you very much, Dan, and all the gentlemen over there at the prediction board. That was a cool segment. I like seeing all these names on the board, but I'm a little offended that Dan compared my predictions to Rob's predictions.
Yeah, I don't know about you being offended. If I was Yozflow, I'd be offended.
Yeah.
Like, Dan just straight up called him a joke pick.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah, but let's not waste any more time. We'll start talking about the first match. Before we do that, we just want to remind you guys, there's so many players. We saw the predictions on the prediction board. That's just 14 of the over 100 players that are participating in the preliminaries throughout the Americas region. Also, we'll be following along with some of the storylines across the weekend. And, of course, at the end of it all, we will be left with those 8 that will be moving on to the Spring Championships. But as Dan mentioned, the first match of the day is going to be a doozy. It's Tides of Time taking on Fibonacci. So, Bob, lay out this matchup for me.
All right. Well, we do see the bans here, and Tides of Time has chosen to ban out Fibonacci's mage, actually. And that's an interesting ban, since Fibonacci is known for his warrior picks. Fibonacci choosing to ban the warrior of Tides of Time, that seems absolutely backwards to me, since Fibonacci is so known for the warrior, and Tides of Time known for freeze mage in a lot of cases.
Yeah. Also, something about the Shaman, too. Like, the Shaman's just such an unknown solid.
Right. The Shaman, I mean, Fibonacci is kind of between a rock and a hard place here because there's at least two decks in Tides of Time's lineup that are kind of out-control control, both Freeze Mage and the Shaman that he has, which is an incredibly slow Shaman build with Elemental Destructions, tons of healing, two Old Gods, Halazeal, all this stuff. So Freeze Mage and the Shaman deck both have the opportunity to out-control Fibonacci's lineup, which is four control decks itself. So he may have found himself in a really awkward spot in terms of which of those decks he wanted to ban.
Yeah, I was actually thinking earlier, I was like, oh yeah, he's gonna ban the Shaman. And Tides is probably gonna ban away the Warrior for the reasons that Bob mentioned. I mean, Fibonacci is probably one of the, you know, most prolific Warrior players in all of the Americas region. He's finished finished number one legend like three times in 2015. Yeah. So a little bit of an interesting choice. Bob, how do you think Rogue is going to perform at this tournament? We saw some of the other casters mention that Rogue was being targeted. Do you think that's the case?
Well, I think in this matchup, it's absolutely going to be at risk for this. The Zoo deck, of course, being very powerful now that Blade Flurry has been taken down to four mana. The Mage deck of Threes Mage, it's going to be able to put up those ice blocks before Fibonacci's Malagos Rogue is going to be able to set up those lethal combos. And unless you can hit them before that ice block comes up, you're a little bit in trouble.
And it's definitely a theme of this championship in general. We already saw Rogue, despite almost being agreed as the best deck in Europe, already performed at 45%, and it's being targeted even more heavily here, but we are ready to get into the first match.
That is correct, which means I will leave you guys in the hands of these two gentlemen, so take it away, boys.
Now, this is absolutely not what you want to see with your first matchup as Tides of Time. Fibonacci starting with his Control Warrior against the Freeze Mage. It's going to be a long game, and unless Tides of Time can close it out before Justicar, which we see in Fibonacci's hand right now, comes down, he's going to be in trouble.
Yeah, there would have been a certain level of mind games here. Tides of Time says, okay, I need to get a win with this Freeze Mage as soon as possible, so I'm going to throw it out there, hope he just doesn't pick the Control Warrior. Fibonacci reads that perfectly, answers with the Control Warrior, and he more or less has a free win on his side. Now, this is one of the most disgustingly bad matchups in Hearthstone.
So Tides of Time is playing out minions early on, and that's what he mulliganed for. These minions are going to be able to keep Fibonacci's armor count down. That way, later on, the massive burst of spells that will come later on is just going to pummel through the rest of his health.
Right, one of the ways you could win this matchup back in the day is just getting a couple of mad scientists down early. There'd be no fiery war axe, and you just pummel away with minions, as you said. But these days, your minions are a little bit weaker. They're even more exposed to things like Whirlwind and Revenge if those are being played. So it's going to be an uphill battle. I think tournament etiquette, or at least ladder etiquette, kind of dictates that as soon as you see Justicar in the Freeze Mage, as the Freeze Mage player in this matchup, the etiquette is just to concede and save everyone half an hour of their time. But this is a very high-stakes game. I'm sure we'll see it get played out.
Now, we do notice that Tides of Time used his hero power here instead of playing out Blood Mage Thalanos. This is actually going to allow him to use that Blood Mage Thalanos later on to set up a larger burst combo with his Frost Bolts, his Ice Lances, and more. But Justicar does come down for Fibonacci, so let the tank up begin.
Yes, indeed. Turn 6, Justicar, the absolute nightmare from the Freeze Mage. That's an excellent point about the Blood Mage. It does need to be saved if you're going to have any hope of winning this matchup. Get a nice Emperor hand on a bunch of burn. Try and deal as much damage as you can in as few turns as possible, because every extra turn you have to break up your burn, that is a gap that the Warrior can use to press their hero power, cast Shield Block, cast Bash, whatever they need to do to gain some life.
Looks like we are going to see Bash and Tank up going down for Fibonacci. We did notice Tides of Time using his hero power last turn as well. Just once again, each time he uses that hero power, it's an opportunity that is going to be lost with each turn. You need to use your hero power every turn, sneak in as much damage as possible.
Right. One thing that does need to be elaborated about this matchup now in the new format is that Shield Maiden is not present. And this is a pure control warrior from Fibonacci. It's not one of the C'Thun warriors that are starting to become popular. So there's no threat of that big ancient shield bearer blowout. The armor gain is almost honest, if you want to put it that way. He can only press the button. You can account for how much he's going to gain.
And Tides of Time using that Frostbolt on Fibonacci, it does serve two purposes. One, he's not going to be able to use weapons to clear out these minions, which are once again putting that little chip damage away at him. And also, he does have to get rid of that armor sometime, so this is not wasted damage where Alexstrasza later on is going to set him to 15.
absolutely right. And he is starting now to stack up a little bit of burn in his hand. Does have that Emperor already. Blood Mage is on the board, so he can choose to take advantage of the spell damage again if he would like to. But this Doomsayer does need to be answered because, as you pointed out quite rightly at the start of the matchup, the fact that Tides has managed to have minions in play for this entire game is a big reason why he's actually a contender here.
Now, we do see that the Fireball not used once again, just to make sure that Alexstrasza is going to get absolutely the maximum amount of damage on Fibonacci here. Emperor Tharsane coming down with a tank up for Fibonacci. Now, with all those cards reduced, he's going to open up a bunch more options from legendary minions in his hand going forward.
Yes, indeed. Frost Nova Doomsayer now going to come out from Tides of Time. Doesn't want to have to commit any damage into killing this Emperor Thorasan. Wants to make sure all his damage is free to go face. So the double Doomsayer play is just going to try and solve this problem right now. But it does mean that Emperor will get one more proc at least.
Yeah, that's going to be tricky. He's got tons of options here. But he just can't play any of them due to having both Doomsayers out there. So Fibonacci set back just one turn. Now we might see some of these fireballs coming out pretty soon. Not this turn, he still wants to sneak in one more hero power, and he doesn't quite have the mana to get that Roaring Torch out.
Yep, so that turn was just a tank up and chill from Fibonacci, and that gave Tides of Time the initiative that he needs to develop his own Emperor on the board. He will hope against hope that there is no removal option in Control Warrior's 9-card hand here to be able to deal with this. Unfortunately, there is, and due to that Emperor getting two activations, he manages to weave in the tank up, deal with the opposing Emperor, and generate an entirely huge amount of pressure with the Ragnaros Firelord.
Fibonacci knows that there aren't a lot of minions that that Fiery War Axe is going to be useful against, so he just goes ahead and swings at a face to make sure he uses all of his mana. But Alexstrasza coming down and bringing Fibonacci down to 15. Tides of Time has 25, now 29 health to get through. And that is still doable.
That is doable. That is a huge draw, both figuratively and literally, from Tides of Time there. Massive Alexstrasza on the board, gets sniped down by Grom, just used as a removal tool. Knows that he doesn't need the burst damage from Grom at this point because Ragnaros represents all the burst damage that he needs. But Tides now is going to start to commit. That's 12 damage being dealt this turn. He has a Pyroblast and an Ice Lance for a follow-up, so he is not quite there yet, but he's trying to make something happen.
Now we do see 11 damage present for Fibonacci, which means he's going to proc this block this turn. That means Tides of Time is going to have to draw either draw cards or additional damage, or else he's just not going to be able to play Ice Block and Pyroblast in the next two turns.
Yeah, there is no single draw that is going to allow him to win the game on the next turn, so he Arcane Intellect is probably his out here. He's going to need Arcane Intellect into specifically one burn spell and the second Ice Block, and then perhaps pick a... Oh, he has a second Ice Block in hand, I apologize. So he's going to need more burn off the top on consecutive draws, doesn't get it, and just gives up the game. Knows that there is no combination of draws that can win him the game from that position.
Right, he was put in a tough spot right from the beginning because of Justicar. If we take a look at how much armor was present from Justicar, whereas if he didn't have Justicar, how much armor would have been there, I believe that might have been just enough damage to set him up. But Alexstrasza did take out a majority of his health, so it might have just been a little extra fluff in the way.
Right, and the mage was kind of in that game for a period, and it was exactly what you said at the start. He was able to stick a couple of minions to the board up until about turn six when the Doomsayer came out from Fibonacci, and that's crucial because you do manage to keep control of the early armor from the warrior just a little bit, but still, as you can see, that matchup is horrible because of the lack of interaction that Alexstrasza has with armor with additional health on top of your normal life total. Just rarely enough damage in the deck to be able to burst through all that armor.
Now, although that win is a free win for the Control Warrior in a way,
yep,
there are free wins available for the Freeze Mage still in Fibonacci's lineup. That Rogue definitely being at risk with Malygos, but certainly not as hard of a counter as the previous one.
Yeah, it is definitely a bad matchup for the Rogue. Rogue, miracle varieties of Rogue, regardless of the win condition, are decks that are fine-tuned to kill you once. And Freeze Mage is a deck that asks you the question, can you kill me three times? And the answer to that usually is no, because quite often they'll have to commit their win condition to deal with either the first or second Ice Block, and then they're just kind of out of damage to try and get through the third time. But looks like we are going to see Zoo here up against the Reno Lock of Fibonacci. We do see Tides of Time running that crazed Alchemist technology.
Now we're going to go in here and see that the crazed Alchemist is going to pair up against that Doomsayer right away. And that is going to be very big. That means that Fibonacci is going to be able to set up that Imp Gang boss on turn three and keep his Argent Squire on the board and develop a 2-2. It's pretty much a hard counter to that play.
Yeah, it looks like Fibonacci is considering not playing the Doomsayer here. This might be a nod to the revealed decklist format of this tournament, where he knows Crazed Alchemist is a card that is in Tide's lineup. He knows it's a card that Tides would keep in this situation. So having watched the Mulligan, he saw cards being kept. There may have been a consideration just to not let him play Crazed Alchemist on curve, at least. But in the end, you saw him considering between the two options. We are going to see the blowout of the Crazed Alchemist hitting the Doomsayer.
And because of that, the Imp Gang boss is not going to be able to go onto an empty board. And here it comes to get some Imps, hopefully, from this. But we do see the Abusive Sergeant, which means that the number of Imps might be limited to just one. Dark Iron Councilman going to go down two, so that the Abusive Sergeant will buff it up to two attack this turn.
Yep, Tides of Time has a very effective full clear this turn if he wants it. This is kind of Zoo 101. Play your small guys, play your buff cards, trade up into their larger minions. You have stuff left over. You stamp your tempo on the board, and you're basically demanding answers from your opponent on any given turn.
Now, with no answer to the Dark Iron Councilman, or the Councilman,
Dark Shire Councilman, yes.
Yeah, we're south of Stormwind there. But without an answer to that, it's going to be tricky. It's going to get very big with each turn, and next turn it's definitely going to grow by at least one, maybe two if he chooses to play Knife Juggler. I can't see a way that Fibonacci is going to be able to come out of this without drawing his Reno or some of his AoE clears down the road.
Yeah, I think the AoE is the more important thing that you're looking for in this matchup. This is almost like the old form of mid-range Druid when it was playing the Force of Nature Savage Roar combo, where you can Reno, that's fine, it's great, it buys you some time, but if you can't address the opponent's board, you're just going to take that damage straight back very, very quickly. So the AoE is the big stuff that he's going to be looking for here. But the 3-5 on the board is relatively competitive right now. He does have the ability to play three minions if he wants and just get a straight 5-5 trade into that 3-5 using the Darkshire Councilman. There's also the option of slamming Defender of Argus on curve, which as a Zoo player never feels like a terrible idea.
Right now he's wondering if Fibonacci does have that Hellfire in hand. If he does, he's going to want to trade out these weaker minions and maybe not commit so much to the board. He did hover over that Dark Peddler, though, so he might have given away that was a 2-drop and potentially doesn't have that Hellfire. So it looks like Tides of Time is just going to commit as much as he can to the board. Juggles both hitting the...
That's so perfect.
Oh, wow. So now he can trade away his weaker minions and make himself less susceptible to AoE.
Yeah, as you said, that 1-in-4 double juggle hit is so important for that card you saw drawn right there. So let's rewind just for a second and live in the world where he was forced to trade that Darkshire Alchemist into the 3-5, he would be in a horrible Hellfire position right there. You probably would have seen him go face to at least mitigate some of the Hellfire, but the same trade still happens at the end of the day.
Yeah, that's right. And this game would have been completely the other way around in that case. Now, Dark Peddler going to draw two cards here. He grabs Possessed Villager and an Argent Squire. So just a couple one drops that he can that are just more powerful, more sticky to hopefully contest this board. But that Darkshire Councilman, he's just going to get bigger and bigger from this point on.
Yeah, such a huge threat, and a threat that was overlooked by a lot of people when the card set was announced. Not too many people were looking at it as a big power card, but it's one of those cards where the first time you see the effect that it has on the board, you suddenly understand everything. It's very Dr. Boom-like in that way.
Now, a bit of an awkward hand for Tides of Time at this point. Defender of Argus and Knife Juggler add up to 6 mana. He's only got 5. He has to decide whether or not he's going to tap for that 1-cost card and play Knife Juggler with it, or take the safer play and play the Defender of Argus. It looks like he's definitely going to consider that safer play a little bit more, revealing that the Defender of Argus isn't his hand.
Yeah, I like the Argus play. I'm interested to see who's going with the positioning here. I kind of like the Argus on the 2/1/3s to turn them into 2/4s and use those two minions to trade into Bran. But again, he gets an excellent juggle that makes his positioning absolutely optimal in terms of the trades that he picks up. So he played for his juggle there and he was rewarded by it in the end.
Looks like Fibonacci is going to be looking for that Shadow Bolt or another 3 damage that he can deal to that Dark Iron Councilman. Because again, it's just getting crazy. But it's not going to get much bigger. Tides of Time only really has options to play two or maybe 3 cards next turn.
Yeah, unless we saw Forbidden Ritual. Wow,
oh,
Leroy
man.
Jenkins. That is 14 damage this turn because of the 1 extra buff. Abusive Sergeant, he does not have the mana for. I'm sure this will be the all-in line from Tides this turn. Jam this 11 damage to face. He is basically demanding Reno Jackson specifically from his opponent here.
It looks like his Fibonacci's draw is a dark... Ooh, a Cult Apothecary. Mm-hmm. So he is actually going to be able to heal out of range of Leroy, but probably not out of range of the entire board, as he's not going to have enough mana to deal with or the cards even to deal with those other two cards.
So yeah, time for some caster maths. He can play Cult Apothecary, heal for 6, which would take him up to 10. He has 1 mana remaining for the Mortal Coil that would let him take care of the Councilman. That would leave 4 damage on board plus the Leroy, which adds up, if I'm counting this correctly, to exactly 10.
So. Now Fibonacci probably should draw first here and get that Mortal Coil out of the way and attack with his minions. He does still have a chance of getting Reno Jackson.
Absolutely, yeah, I completely agree with you, but it does mean he would heal for 2 less. But it's just a matter of whether... I think the healing first is correct, because if he was to whiff on any draw, he's suddenly dead to just Power Overwhelming or just Soulfire the way it went.
So. Funny enough, he did actually draw Senjin Shieldmaster, which would have protected him here, but this is going to be lethal damage, and Tides of Time is going to take game number 2.
Yep, Tides of Time squares up the series. Very, very important juggler interaction in the early game, which decided a lot of the AoE decisions from his opponent. Hellfire not being as effective as it could have been, but you saw Tides very deliberately throughout that game kind of taking the risk that his juggler would behave in the way that he wanted it. He was trying to push the really optimal plays that didn't happen all the time instead of the conservative plays that kind of ignored what the juggler was going to do. And he was rewarded for that in the end, because that is a matchup where you are playing the aggressive deck. You're dictating the tempo of the matchup. So a lot of the time, it's absolutely correct to take those risks and hope that you come out ahead.
And 3/4 of all the other universes there, that juggle misses, and suddenly that Hellfire is looking a lot better.
Yeah, I'm terrified at the idea of alternate Hearthstone universes. This is not a world that I want to get into very quickly, but the series is tied up 1 game apiece here. We have seen the Control Warrior pick up a victory. We have seen the Zoo pick up a victory. So Fibonacci is down to his Reno Lock and his Maligos Rogue against Tides' Control Shaman and the Freeze Mage of his own, I believe. Yeah, that's right.
This is going to be interesting because Tides of Time still has that Freeze Mage. He didn't just throw it out right away. He wanted to pick up 1 more win before that. I'm not sure exactly what he was targeting with his Zoo Lock, if he was targeting that Reno Lock, or if maybe he was targeting that Rogue. I guess the Zoo actually was pretty good against the remainder
of the
lineup.
Yeah, I think against the field, the Zoo was a smart choice, especially this is the Malagos version of Miracle Rogue, which is one of the slower variants, and therefore the version that can get punished by a deck like Zoo the hardest. So the Zoo pick with that there definitely makes a lot of sense. The way this series has kind of played out is basically that Tides picked up that his Freeze Mage might be a weak link. It could just lose that game to Control Warrior. Threw it out early to try and pick up that wing. Fibonacci kind of outmind games him on the game 1 pick, but that's kind of dictated the way that the lineups progress from there.
Mind games has definitely been a big factor in this, even with the bans going forward. The real question I have is, will Tides of Time's Shaman be able to use that Shaman and actually pull off a win? It was very successful on ladder, but against these other 2 decks, it might be a little too slow to stop the Malagos from the Rogue and get OTK'd from it, and it might be a little too slow for the Reno Lock, which could establish some earlier board presence with some stronger minions that Stormcrack and other spells, removal spells, just might not be able to handle.
Yeah, if you guys aren't familiar with the Shaman list, if you haven't seen Tides play it on stream, you're in for a treat. We're talking Yogg-Saron, we're talking N'Zoth, we're talking Ysera, double Healing Wave, double Elemental Destruction, a bunch of Overload unlock cards, just a whole bunch of wackiness. And this is kind of Tides 101. Tides is a player who is most at home when he gets to tinker with deck lists, when he gets to try crazy stuff. And I think this is why he's so motivated with Standard right now. He's also a very emotional player, shall we say. I think he values his own peace of mind and his own happiness over just, oh, I have to be a competitive Hearthstone player. So he only really tries and takes the game very seriously in periods where he's enjoying the game. And I think right now with Standard, he's enjoying the game a lot. And a motivated Tides is a scary Tides.
Absolutely. And hey, now you want to talk about motivation and ways to just have fun. Yogg-Saron, that old god, is the card that is the definition of fun for many right now. Literally anything could happen with that. And even any Finn is a part of that anything that could happen.
Have you ever cast Yogg-Saron, cast any Finn, and actually have Murlocs come back? Because I've seen it cast a couple of times, but never for actual Murlocs. I think
I've never seen that yet, but okay. I'm sure it's coming.
Personally, me, as the massive sourpuss of the Hearthstone casting community, I am not the hugest fan of Yogg-Saron, but I totally appreciate the dynamic that it brings to situations like this. I'm sure it'll create some crazy opportunities during this weekend.
Now let's talk about an interesting card in Tide's lineup, and that is Chill-Maw in the Shaman. So Chill-Maw is actually there to synergize with N'Zoth, And he doesn't have any dragons to activate Chilmaw's Death Rattle, too. So Chilmaw's actually finding some interesting use here outside of dragon decks.
Right, the Chilmaw-Nazoth synergy is kind of weird because the first Chilmaw is often very good because you're playing a slow, control-y deck that wants to AoE the board. But the second Chilmaw that comes back from your Nazoth kind of works against you. So it's interesting in this list from Tides that he is, as you say, playing it just as the 7-mana 6-6 taunt body. But just to let you guys know that we do have a small delay. Fibonacci ran into a small issue. He's having to restart his client, so we'll be getting into game 3 as soon as possible. Shouldn't be too long from now, guys. But still, yeah, this Shaman deck, incredibly exciting. Looking forward to it. I think Elise is thrown in there as well, if I remember rightly. So he has all sorts of control counters. But would you expect to see the Shaman coming out next, or is he going to look to his Freeze Mage at this point?
I think at this point he is going to go for the Freeze Mage just to establish another win. I think the Shaman is a little bit at risk of running into that Rogue, and you kind of want to just get that win on the Rogue with the Freeze Mage instead. So if you pull that off, great.
Rogue, one of the better decks in the game at punishing this kind of greedy control, because they just get to tempo out too quickly. Sap is a hell of a card. They burst you from nowhere. So that makes a lot of sense. But yeah, I love the Freeze Mage pick here. As you said, we've already talked about the Freeze Mage versus Miracle dynamic. The Freeze Mage versus Reno Lock dynamic has changed a lot now, because Reno Jackson is kind of the only healing left in the deck now. We did see the Cult Apothecary, but that's not going to be an effective card against Freeze Mage. So you're down to the point where the strategy for that matchup now becomes you kind of just trade a Fireball for their Reno at some point in the game. You just Fireball them in the face once. They're forced to Reno in response, and then you Alexstrasza them, and the game's kind of over. So, tough matchup.
22 health is not safe.
Nope.
And there's been some interesting matches where people have played around 22 health, playing Reno Jackson at that point, only to see Alexstrasza hit them next turn. So you're having to fight that dichotomy.
Right.
Do you put Reno Jackson down before the Alexstrasza or after the Alexstrasza? Brand Bronzebeard, though, does play a good role in this matchup, because if you have him and one of your heals, you get that kind of old Healbot effect from Refreshment Vendor, from Cult Apothecary.
Right, yeah, Vendor can do some work with Bran for sure, but the Cult Apothecary is still really not going to get a lot done against Freeze Mage, because there aren't going to be minions there for you to leverage against. But yeah, you're absolutely right. I think 21 is the max damage that you can deal under normal conditions, but after Emperor comes down, all bets are off. Like, it could be any number coming at you from hand.
Unless you get that early pressure, that Emperor is almost a certainty.
Right. It certainly is. So yeah, I'm totally with you. I think Freeze Mage is the intelligent pick here from Tides, and I honestly don't think there's anything that Fibonacci can use to counter that. Like, which of these two decks do you pick? It's kind of rock and a hard place here. I think Fibonacci will know that the Freeze Mage is coming, but Reno Lock or Maliroad, kind of a toss-up, right?
You got to be thinking about, if the Shaman is coming, what do I play? Mm. I know I'm going to probably lose to the Freeze Mage. So if he does have that Mind Game Shaman pick, can I pick off the win with my Rogue? So I think we'll see Fibonacci pick the Rogue in this situation. However, the Reno Lock is not without a chance against that Freeze Mage. I mean, if you get those early game minions, and you do have a lot of them in the deck, you might be able to beat him down and get him into lethal range.
Makes a lot of sense, and yeah, as predicted, we do see the Freeze Mage coming out from Tides, and Fibonacci is in fact chosen to go for the Reno Lock, keeps the Reno Jackson, no surprise, you keep that card in most matchups, it's the entire reason you're playing the deck, so yeah, we apologize for the delay, but we are ready to go with Game 3 right now.
Great curve for Fibonacci right off the start with the Dark Peddler. It's going to open up a second card right away, and the Demon Wrath up there to take out all those little minions down the road. So he is going to open with this Dark Peddler, I'm sure.
Yep, Dark Peddler makes a lot of sense. It does get incredibly easily contested by this Loot Hoarder, but that's really not what this matchup is about. And even better, he picks up the Mortal Coil to be able to solve that problem.
All right. Well, let the beatdown begin, Dark Peddler. We'll see if you can take out enough health from that mage to put the pressure on.
The Dark Peddler 15-turn clock has been activated. Let's go.
All right, well, unfortunately, that Dark Peddler is not very good against an Acolyte of Pain. Tide's going to probably get two guaranteed draws off that card. There is an opportunity here to play the Shadow Bolt, though, and prevent that at this point.
Yeah, he had a couple of options there to theoretically prevent draws from that Acolyte. He could have played Doomsayer down, but there's an option there for the Freeze Mage to just ping their own Acolyte, then trade into the 2-2, pick up those two draws anyway. Plus, Doomsayer is actually a valuable strategic card in this matchup, because you can try and time it against an Emperor drop from your opponent, against an Alexstrasza drop, all these sorts of things.
Not only that, you just don't want to kill your own Dark Peddler, Ovitz.
Right? Yeah, absolutely.
The clock is still on. Couple Novice Engineers going to go down, so the Dark Peddler now contested pretty well. There aren't... Oh, hey, great pickup from Fibonacci. He gets the Twilight Drake off the top, and that's going to be a big threat here for Tide the Time.
Yeah, Twilight Drake comes down as a 4-9, but it is still a relatively ignorable threat, and Tide's tends to assess the situation in the same way, chooses to ignore it, just play out his Emperor. I think one of the key cards that we might see coming up here in a couple of turns is that Ragnaros Fire Lord in Fibonacci's hand, because as we saw in the previous game against Freeze Mage when Fibonacci was playing Control Warrior, once Ragnaros hits on the board, that's your pressure locked up for the whole game. You can focus on being purely defensive at that point.
Now Fibonacci is taking care of this board with his Demon Wrath, damaging his own Twilight Drake, and that is because he wants to save that Siphon Soul. Tide the Time setting up his turn 8 Alexstrasza here as well. Unfortunately, Reno Jackson and Bran and Earthen Ring Farseer. There's lots of healing options for Fibonacci that might keep him out of range of Tide the Time.
Yeah, it's interesting. I talked about Healbot being the only big heal outside of Reno Jackson left, but these small incremental heals might be enough to get the job done here, and I'm interested in seeing Tides of Time go down this line. He set it up from almost three turns out where he's going to go for this aggressive early Alexstrasza. He does have the damage in hand to back it up, but Alexing before you've seen Reno in this matchup is definitely a risky strategy to go with.
Well, he's not going to, Fibonacci not going to be able to take care of both the Alexstrasza and use the Reno right here, so he's just going to have to use the maximum amount of healing he can do, which is Siphon Soul and Earthen Ring Farseer. This brings him up to 21 health. Tides has Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance, Forgotten Torch, and a Ping, which is going to bring him up to 6. Let's add it up. 9.
The second Fireball draw as well. Changes a lot here. So yeah, what does he have? Fireball, Frostbolt is 9. Ice Lance, 13. Forgotten Torch, 16. Ping, 17, if I've counted that correctly.
Yeah, I think that's it.
So then he still has Pyroblast to follow up on a following turn. But yeah, again, committing more burn now at this point. Because as you said, you don't really necessarily get a read that there's no Reno from that action on the previous turn because Alexstrasza was forced to be dealt with. So I doubt we're going to see an all-in line here. Forgotten Torch to face is essentially free. It's damage to face that puts more damage in your deck over the course of the game, so that makes a lot of sense. And this line sets him up for a lethal next turn anyway if there is no heal.
Right, Fibonacci pretty much given the hint that, hey, if you're using burn now, you probably got the rest of the damage. I'd better pull out this Reno at this point. And it's absolutely the safest play. Alexstrasza has already been played. You're only going to get, heal to 30 one time here. So,
yeah, absolutely. So he gets himself up to 30. He's going to play his Bran down afterwards, it looks like, missing that double heal to 30 value, just saving himself a bit of time for animations. But now Tides is back to square one. And as I said, this is the risk of kind of being the first to shoot in this matchup by you committing your Alexstrasza first. Pyroblast gets 10 done, and he is now sat with 12, 15, 19 damage remaining in hand, but not enough mana to do it all in one turn.
He's only one short, which means that Fibonacci is going to either need to use that Jiraxxus to heal up to 15 after a burst turn, or he's going to have to draw that Refreshment Vendor. With Bran on the board, he will be able to get up to 8 with that.
And I think one turn we glossed over, because there is a lot to talk about in this matchup, Fibonacci chose to drop Emperor into the Doomsayer on that turn that it was played, just to get the discount. And that allowed him, into the Alexstrasza turn, to play Siphon Soul and heal in the same turn. It's essentially accelerated his recovery options by that one turn he's needed to still be relatively okay in this matchup right now.
Now, Tides right now is considering how much burn do I want to use on Fibonacci's face, and he has to be considering cards like Jiraxxus. If he brings him below 15, that enables Jiraxxus as a heal. If he keeps him at a lower life total than 15, or I'm sorry, a higher life total than 15, he is actually going to be able to finish him off with a big round of burst.
Yeah, pick the one damage to face here is a totally valid option because he does have 19 damage exactly stacked up in hand with 9 mana. But that one Loot Hoarder on the board actually activates Cult Apothecary and pulls Fibonacci back out of range here if he wants to.
Well, not quite out of range because remember, that Loot Hoarder is going to be able to attack.
That's very true.
So Cult Apothecary.
Cult Apothecary's Shadow Flame is the play he needs to stay alive.
He actually, you were right. Bran is still on the board. So that is going to be a heal for 4.
Very true.
So he'll be just out of range with 2 health with that. It's got to be the play here. And hey, you could still Shadow Flame. You could Shadow Flame the Earthen Ring Farseer just to have so you don't have a pingable board at that point. Shadow Flame the Bran so you have more damage.
Leroy Cult Apothecary.
Oh,
is
man,
interesting
even better
stuff.
Play.
Yeah, that does not leave mana left over for the Shadow Flame, though, so that 4 damage will remain on the board. But for every whelp that gets summoned, he's essentially healing himself for 4 here, so the value is there because of that Bran on board.
Cult Apothecary actually looking like way better heal bot.
It is a spicy play because Bran in play gives 4 whelps to the opponent. So then Cult Apothecary will be a heal back to full. He'll go back to 30 again if he makes that play.
Looks like he's opting for the Faceless Manipulator and the taunt, though.
He's dead.
Just going to block 2 damage. And
he has died.
He's going to be dead.
Chooses not to take the healing line here, which is an interesting decision. I guess he felt like his last heal in hand needed to get a little bit more value. Second Ice Lance may have made it all irrelevant in the long run anyway. That's the extra damage he may have needed. But he is going to fire his entire hand at Fibonacci's face, and Tides of Time goes up 2-1 in this series.
Some spicy plays there, and I think Fibonacci might be looking back to this VOD later on and wondering, hey, if I made this other play, would that have saved me? Would I have been dead anyway? He's just got to look back.
It's not like we caught a play that he didn't, because him picking up the Leeroy is the whole thing that sent me down that line. But that is a really interesting line, right? You give them extra whelps. Each whelp that you give them heals you not just for 2, but for 4, because the Bran is still there. So
ultimately, maybe the Bran was the reason he decided not to play the Leeroy. He didn't want to set that board up to take out his own board. He knew, hey, I might only have 2 turns left anyway.
Yep. Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. I think he just valued his last remaining heal. Jiraxxus is a heal, but it's a situational heal. Yeah. Your opponent has to go all in. So his last remaining heal, he probably felt like he needed 1 more turn to survive. And then that little extra bit of value he could get out of that last heal would have sealed up the game. So he took a calculated risk in a bad matchup, much like Tides did early on with the Knife Juggler plays, but it didn't pay out for him. He's going to find himself trailing in the series, now still needing a win with his Reno Lock and with his, what else does he have remaining? His Malygos Rogue, of course.
Mm-hmm. I think the Malygos Rogue is going to have a little bit better matchup against the Shaman. We might see that to come out first. Maybe Fibonacci can gauge a little bit about how Tides of Time will play, get a little bit of information on his style, although he's certainly done a lot of information getting that in the field. Definitely favors putting out your stronger matchup there.
Bob, are you excited? Because it's Shaman time.
There's
no way around it.
Hey.
It is Shaman time. We are going to see this list. I think this is one of the most hyped lists of the tournament, Tides of Time's Control Shaman. As I said, he's been playing it to great success, honestly, on ladder during his streams. Big fan of the deck. He thinks it's a big meta crusher in this format, expects it to do really, really well. I can't wait to see how it plays out. Are you expecting it to do well, not just in this series, but perhaps in the tournament as a whole?
I'm expecting some mixed results from it. I do believe it's still very susceptible to OTK, and we do have Malygos Rogues. We've got Leeroy Jenkins.
We've got some Anyfins as well.
And we've got the Murloc decks, and because of those OTK decks, it might be a little dicey down the road. But we are going to jump into game number 4 here, and a couple weaker hands here from both players. Looks like Fibonacci did, though, go with the Reno Lock.
I mean, I guess he has. At this point, there is only one deck remaining. He has to win with both of his decks regardless. There's no idea, there's no strategy in terms of concealing information in this format because the information's all out there anyway. So honestly, just pick the one you feel like playing right now. There isn't much more to it than that. You have to get the job done with both anyway.
Tides of Time is looking through this hand. Good mulligan strategy against Reno Lock would probably be to get more removal cards here. Possibly some big AoEs for his weaker minions that are going to be played out first. Tides of Time does not have a weapon in the deck, so that's Acidic Swampoos in Fibonacci's hand. Probably not going to be held out. It's probably going to be used as a tempo play early on.
Yeah, normally you queue into a Shaman on ladder, you get that Acidic Swampoos in your opening hand, you're like, oh baby, we've got this one. But yeah, no such luck against Tides' deck. Not even the Hammer of Twilight is being used, which is a card that some people who have messed around with Control Shaman are favoring a little bit, especially since it's kind of Harrison resistant, which is a nice thing in the current format where there's a lot of Harrison. You get your weapon Harrison, there's a 4-2 on the board to trade into the 5-4.
Tides very quickly throwing down Totem there. Ancestral Knowledge would overload him for quite a bit. And hey, his Totem there is a Taunt Totem, which is going to protect that Mana Tide Totem from anything that Fibonacci could throw down.
And Fibonacci is going to throw down the Imgang boss. He has got a relatively strong early hand here for the Reno Lock. Coins out the Imgang boss on turn 3, has the option to go with Peddler into a 1-drop on turn 3. Pick up a 1-drop option here, something to commit to the board. Abusive Sergeant and Mortal Coil, both strong cards, but not appropriate for this situation right now, so he's going to keep the Abusive Sergeant in hand, most likely for some flexibility later on.
If that wasn't a Taunt Totem, I'm pretty sure he would have picked the Mortal Coil there, but this Abusive will actually allow him to use his minion to take out one minion to take out that Mana Tide, or that's what he thought, until Thing from Below came down. This is why Tides use that totem on turn two instead of playing a minion,
yep.
Reducing the cost of Thing from Below.
Yeah, the value of pressing the totem button in Shaman these days is just exponentially higher because, sure, you lose a tiny bit of initial tempo, but sometimes not even that because you can use those bodies on the board for tempo with Flame Tongue Totem anyway. But then it opens up these turns later where you can just explode with these discounted Things from Below. This turn, not the most explosive thing, 4 mana, still excellent value for a 5-5 taunt, but most importantly, protected that Mana Tide Totem one more turn.
Yeah, the Black Knight up there is certainly not going to be useful against that Thing from Below, but Chillmaw is coming up, so Black Knight might actually be relevant here. Ysera not in the hand of Tides of Time, which means Chillmaw will not be able to proc just yet. It could be used as a taunt. Now, the play up right now, Tides is probably thinking about, hey, can I protect this Mana Tide Totem? Have I gotten enough value out of it yet? Or is it time to do something else? So he might be thinking of using that Lava Shock after drawing some cards with Ancestral Knowledge. Gotta be careful, though. Getting close to overdrawing.
Yeah, he does have that Elemental Destruction in hand, though, and right now that Lava Shock is the only unlock that he has, so he might be considering keeping those two cards to play together. Picks up the Ysera, which means now Chillmaw will be activated when it drops to the board, which at least mitigates the Black Knight a little bit. The Black Knight will take a little bit of damage on the backswing.
He probably wants to activate Emperor here on the next turn, which really brings me to think
right.
He's going to play Lava Shock.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
He could also play Sylvanas if his if Fibonacci plays some larger minion. There aren't a whole lot of larger minions. Maybe a Twilight Drake on the next turn he might be thinking about. Of course, we see he doesn't have that here. Just going to go ahead and use that Lava Shock. Protect that Mana Tide for one more draw.
Yep, and he's successfully matching the resource battle with the class that has access to Life Tap, which is kind of crazy considering this Mana Tide Totem is just going wild right now and is just actually drawing him all the options that he could possibly need. So now, with the 4-8 on the board, do we like Sylvanas or do we like Emperor?
I think we're going to play Sylvanas here. I mean, you've got to have a chance to steal that card from the board. You really don't have a lot of you don't want to hex a Twilight Drake. They're great death rattle cards. You're going to want to use that on against Fibonacci.
Yep, certainly there's Ragnaros that is a huge threat. There'll be the opposing Sylvanas as well. All sorts of things that you want to answer, but he is going to choose just to go ahead and hex. So he's taking a slow line here, commits the Blood Mage to the board. So Tides, of course, we're all flying by the seat of our pants a little bit here. No one really knows the strategy of this deck better than Tides of Time, considering it's his homebrew creation. So he says that it's correct to hex there and just keep on playing this game slowly. So if he says that's correct, I'm just going to trust him.
Yeah, he does have two hexes in hand, so yep. Maybe he's thinking, hey, this game's going to actually be quite quick. I'm drawing most of my deck. My win condition will be coming soon. I can just go ahead and use one of my hexes now and make sure that I don't need a second hex for larger minions down the road. He's got a bit of a tougher decision this turn. He does know that his Mana Tide Totem's days are most likely numbered and probably decided he's going to stop protecting that guy now. Don't really want to overdraw. He's having trouble not drawing two cards every turn. And that's actually going to cause him to have, I think, is that 10 cards in hand?
He does have 10 cards in hand right now.
So he's going to overdraw.
Yes, he will, but still, that discount is pretty enormous. But yeah, looks like we may see the end of the road here for Mana Tide Totem. He's put his work in, but now his watch has ended. He is going to bite the dust, but still, he is the reason for this 10-card hand right now for Tides of Time. And Tides of Time will just be praying that this is not too bad.
Karen
is a high-value card, but still, Ysera, Sylvanas, Chillmaw, plenty of gas still in the hand from Tides of Time.
Well, I'm not sure that Karen would have been the play this turn. He does have a great option to play Ysera here, but he's still waiting to fish out that Siphon Soul or one of the bigger removals from Fibonacci. So he's going to just play out this Chillmaw, get another Death Rattle out so that N'Zoth later on will be able to pick something back up.
Yep, but unfortunately, you invited the wrong guy for Netflix and Chillmaw. The Black Knight is going to come out right now and just ruin Tides of Time's dreams. Huge mana swing on the board, tempo passed over. The totem bites the dust to the death rattle as well. We're going to have to see the lightning storm come out now to clear some of this mess up.
Oh, Mana Tide, you have betrayed me once. I will not play you again in this situation. Looks like Sylvanas is going to go down here. Very easy clear thanks to Chillmaw's wonderful death rattle there, dealing 3 damage to all minions on the board. And another totem, which is going to make Thing from Below, his second one in the deck, a little bit cheaper. Might be a factor a little bit later on.
Bran comes into the hand. Nothing particularly exciting with the Bran this turn. We did see that Power Overwhelming in hand, which could have made some spicy plays with the Sylvanas if he was to pick that up. But Leroy means he's starting to assemble some burst damage of his own here, but it looks like it's just going to be a relatively unexciting play of Cult Apothecary just to pick up a bit of healing.
Just wants to deal a little bit of damage here. That way, if he picks up a Hellfire or his in-deck Mortal Coil. Hey.
It's just, what is this deck? Every time a new card is drawn, I've looked at the list in detail, and I'm still surprised when some of these cards are getting drawn. Just Elise in Shaman, guys. This is the world in which we now live.
Elise, of course, the alternate win condition to Nazoth. So after you've drawn all these answers and you're playing against a control deck, which maybe doesn't necessarily put a whole lot of minions on the board for your AoEs to take it out, this gives you another option here. All those AoEs can then be turned into legendary minions, which are much better against control decks.
Wow! Instant map pickup. That Manatai just throws that map into the hand immediately, so we might be able to see a quick golden monkey here.
But it is.
The mind control tech is going to be a big deal, but gets the Manatai, which honestly Tides probably won't be too upset about. Definitely didn't want to lose the Sylvanas there, but the 3-5 on the board actually represents good pressure as well. And honestly, the card draw portion of proceedings has kind of been done by Tides at this point. I think he's happy with how far through his deck he is at this point.
Yeah, Fibonacci actually unable to tap here as a result, as he's going to have 8 cards in hand, and if he taps, go up to 9. So he's going to have to play a couple minions here. He decides to play Brand after the Defender of Argus. That way,
which makes sense.
Yeah, that way if Sylvanas, you know, Sylvanas is not going to be able to kill herself on something, but I mean, he is opening himself up to this Lightning Storm. There's going to be a little bit of RNG here. Lightning Storm might deal only 3 damage to those 4 health minions, and there are 3 of them on the board.
Picks up 1-4 on a relevant target, but it was the most relevant target. The 4-4 minion was the one that he didn't want to trade into, so a reasonably average result, all things considered there. Can pick up these trades without too much combat damage on his minions here.
Halaziel probably not going to be that relevant in this matchup other than as a body, since Handlock isn't really looking to deal a whole bunch of damage to you with its minions. It does have that burst later on, but you're not going to be able to get a whole lot of healing off of it just yet.
Right. The damage doesn't come in increments that you can heal out with all in one go at one point. They just kind of whittle you down a little bit, and then you die from around 20. So it may be useful to pull him back up from around 20 to close to full, but it's not going to be a huge impact.
Fibonacci considering Twisting Nether here in most cases, but he knows Nazoth is in the deck, and Twisting Nether is pretty much the best follow-up to most Nazoth plays, other than ones with sticky minions like Cairn. With Cairn being blown, though, Twisting Nether is a heck of a lot better now. So it looks like he is just going to take a risk here, hope his opponent doesn't have that burn in hand, and just discount his cards.
Yeah, my Shaman instincts took over there. I saw the Brave Emperor play come down, and my initial instinct was like, how much damage does the Shaman have this turn? The sum total before that Lightning Bolt was drawn was 0. That's how much damage he had. This is a very different animal of Shaman deck, but he is still threatening lethal now. We will be forced to see a defensive option come out here from Fibonacci.
I think we're going to see a Shadow Flame on a Sylvanas here. He wants, again, to clear the board without using Twisting Nether just yet.
Yep.
Another option might be, hey, maybe I throw my combo away and play your Leroy and Shadow Flame that. But then you've lost your win condition, so he's probably not considering that line of play. There is, of course, throwing away one of your Power Overwhelming here. Also probably not wise. You're going to lose your win condition. So unfortunately, Sylvanas is not going to get a steal here, and this is going to be the best line of play.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's actually a really interesting decision, because is this a matchup that you're going to win through Leroy Burst, or is it a game that you're going to win through high-quality minions like Sylvanas? It's something that you'd have to consider. It's something that you very much have to figure out on the fly, because this isn't a matchup that anybody has experience with.
Now, Fibonacci is probably going to play Rag here and set up lethal with his combo. He also has an option of preventing himself from dying with Reno Jackson, but he didn't take the defensive play in the previous game with the Freeze Mage. I don't see him taking the defensive play here. Oh, looks like he's going to do it, though.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, he will see the deck list, and there is almost 0 burst in the deck list. There's a couple of one rock barrier and a couple of lightning bolts, I believe. So he's extremely unlikely to die from that point. Could have gone for the aggressive line with Rag, but I will say, early on, it's a play we talked about a lot. He saw a hex used liberally on a Twilight Drake. That may have given him the read that the second hex is in hand already. He doesn't want to commit the biggest threat in his deck to the board just yet.
Looks like Ysera picked up Nightmare, which is definitely not going to set up any sort of lethal damage from Tides just yet. Spellbreaker, a great option on Ysera here, prevent it from drawing some of the dream cards that you would normally see here. He does have the option of facelessing the Ysera, but again, he's probably saving that for the Leeroy Burst at this point. So he's going to go with that Spellbreaker. Interestingly enough, the Shadow Bolt going to go out here and help his Reno Jackson take out that thing from below and once again open up the path of attack for his Leeroy combo.
Yeah, again, the strategy from Fibonacci hit a crossroads on that previous turn. He could have chosen to use up his burst combo and had Sylvanas as a potential answer for this Ysera. He could have followed that up by then facelessing the Ysera on this turn, but he has decided on the previous turn he wants to keep his burst combo intact. So the play that he makes this turn, not using the faceless, using the silence instead, that's 100% consistent. And that's one thing, at least, if you're not sure how the matchup works out, at least pick a strategy and be consistent with it.
Short of a Siphon Soul, Ysera is going to be relevant on the board for a couple more turns. A lucky Ragshot might be able to take out the remaining 8 health after one of those minions slams into it. Tides of Time, probably not thinking that he's going to be dead anytime soon, but he might as well just go ahead and heal up that little bit of extra health he's missing. Players are running out of cards at this point, though. Both players have 4 cards remaining in their deck, so that Manatee Totem, it helped him keep pace with Life Tap in this case.
Right, and 2 of Tides' 4 remaining cards are N'Zoth and Yogg-Saron. So he has bombs for days left in his deck. I believe the 3rd is a healing wave. Not sure on what the 4th one is at this point. So he still has plenty of gas left in his deck. There is Yogg-Saron. Possibly not time for this yet. We'll see the Hex come out first and foremost. Plenty of spells to be cast out here. That double elemental destruction has sat relatively dead in this matchup so far, but he is starting to reassert his board dominance, which he lost with that Shadow Flame turn.
I think N'Zoth is going to be a little bit delayed. He really wants to wait for that Twisting Nether to come out. Mm-hmm. If he doesn't get that Twisting Nether out, then N'Zoth is pretty much going to be irrelevant. So I believe the win conditions for Tides of Time remaining are a N'Zoth after a Twisting Nether or Elise.
Oh, the last card is the monkey, of course. The right. There is Healing Wave and a monkey left in his deck on top of the N'Zoth. You're
those
absolutely right.
Elemental destructions are not looking very good since you destroy your own board. Now yep. We can turn those into relevant cards.
So yeah, this is where we're going to see from Tides. Is the game of chicken going to be played out here where he tries to bait out the Twisting Nether before the N'Zoth happens? Or is he just happy to say, okay, I'll trade my N'Zoth for your Twisting Nether and we'll play from there. I think I have enough left in my deck to do the job. It'll be interesting to see. Looks like, yep, he is going to try and bait out that Twisting Nether first and foremost. Just deal with this board because, of course, the option to play N'Zoth and just say, well, okay, if you Nether, then at least you're taking care of your own board as well. That was an option that was presented to him. But he's going to go down the line of just keeping this 4-8 in play, dealing damage every turn.
Well, Jiraxxus might be the only option here. He's got to start getting threats on the board that can deal with that Ysera. He knows. Fibonacci knows the Twisting Nether has to be saved.
Yep.
And if you set yourself to 15 when you're in fatigue, you're going to die relatively quickly. So here we go. It's time for Jiraxxus.
It certainly is, and this is why I called it a game of chicken on the previous turn. Both players know exactly what's happening right now. This is a game of N'Zoth versus Twisting Nether, and whoever flinches first is likely to lose. Siphon Soul being the last card is kind of a problem for Fibonacci, but still, it's a great pickup right now.
That's going to prevent the Twisting Nether from being played here. Or actually, it's going to help him keep it in his hand.
Right.
That way he can keep relevant board here and have the Twisting Nether for N'Zoth. And then, after Twisting Nether, be able to use that hero power and get a 6-6 on the board by itself.
Yep, so Tides does have to flinch first here. He's almost forced to play N'Zoth. He can try and wait one more turn and essentially make Fibonacci lose more value in terms of 6-6s over the course of the game by Twisting Nethering his own board. But he knows the full burst combo is still intact. So if he waits very long here, those healing waves will now only heal for 7 apiece. You cannot win a joust with no cards in your deck. So the burst healing is not there. So he's probably committed to N'Zoth here, unless he wants to go down the Yogg-Saron line first. But that seems dangerous.
So N'Zoth, of course, going to draw out the Twisting Nether and the hero power from Fibonacci. Looks like he's going to Nightmare and maybe try to set his opponent a little bit lower since there's no more big heals left in the deck. Only Earthen Ring Farseer. It's going to be tricky. Fibonacci has to find 30 damage now. Well, actually, he has to find 10 damage. So he has to survive 4 rounds of fatigue without Tides casting a heal.
Yeah, I mean, what that nightmare was about is twofold. One, lower your opponent's health. Two, cast another spell. And both of those lead to the same point, which is where he's going to try the all-in Yogg-Saron play on this turn, is what I would expect to see. And this gives it maximum chances of doing what he wants it to do. He's actually not. He's going to go for the totem line here. This is interesting.
That is interesting because he's dead if he doesn't deal with the 6-6 or heal himself. So
I mean, he is dead just to fatigue damage. 20 from hand plus the weapon. Even if the board is clear, he dies to fatigue. So he is in a bit of a problem here. I felt like Yogg was his best hope. Just try and do, what, 6 damage he would need to his opponent to kill him on the fatigue draw for 2 on the next turn?
I think right now he's thinking he's probably going to have to heal and play the Golden Monkey to block the Leroy combo. It's about the last thing left in his playbook at the moment. And unfortunately, that Golden Monkey is going to get wiped right off the board by the 6-6. So it's all up to the legendaries now. And as Yogg-Saron unfortunately makes his appearance, and he's not going to be an actor in this game, I believe.
So if he was to heal, play the Golden Monkey, how much did he fatigue for on this turn? Was it 2?
2, because Blood Mage actually drew him a card.
Right, okay. So on the following turn, it passes back to him. He gets hit down to 27, then fatigues down to 24, and then he is yet again dead on the following turn.
So this is it. Fibonacci going to play the combo. I think that's a misplay on Tide's part. He has to have been able to calculate that damage. You haven't seen a Power Overwhelming played yet because Dark Peddler was not a Power Overwhelming. So it's always 20 damage, plus 6 from the board, 3 from the hand, and your fatigue. That's exactly 30.
Right.
Well, it's more than 30, but
It objectively is a mistake because the deck list is revealed.
Yes.
Tides knows the cards that are remaining in his opponent's hand, and he made a play that meant he was dead. That is by definition not the best play you can make. There is no justification for that.
Right.
So you have to call it a mistake. Of course, the game did go on for nearly 20 turns at the end of it. So fatigue, like real life fatigue, is a factor. Things can slip your mind. Tides may have just decided that there was no win condition in that game overall. I think there was definitely no win condition in that game once he pressed Totem. He could have slammed the Yogg-Saron. That was a possible win condition. Once he committed that 2 mana to the Totem, I think the game was locked out. I don't think there was any way to win. But yeah, bizarre line just to leave himself dead on board there at the end.
Yeah, we're going to have to wait for Yogg-Saron to get uploaded to Wolfram Alpha to make to know what the percent chance of winning was for that, or some kind of MATLAB thing going on there to calculate the odds, because right now no one's got a serious outcome list for Yogg-Saron and what those percentages are for certain outcomes. Well, we're on to the fifth game. It's going to be Miracle Rogue versus that crazy Shaman deck once again.
And this is a matchup we both expressed a little bit of concern about. We feel like, and we're figuring this out on the fly as much as anyone else is, but we both feel like this is the kind of deck that Rogue preys upon. This is their natural food and drink. These clunky, slow decks is what they can deal with quite effectively, but what you do have to throw into the mix is that the Gadgezan Conceal line is not a freebie in this matchup. There is the Elemental Destruction to potentially answer it.
Right, and if we look at what Fibonacci's game plan is here, it's probably going to be use as little of my spell damage as possible. Try not to use those Eviscerates on minions. That way I save those for Malagos at the end and get as much burst in one turn as possible. So Tides is going to have to counter that strategy by getting as many minions on the board that can't be handled and threatening through that.
Double Sinister Strike in Fibonacci's list as well is a very big deal, because this deck packs healing, but the double Sinister Strike list is very capable of an OTK turn if given enough time.
That is 16 damage with Malagos.
Right, exactly. And then if you add Eviscerates and Shivs on top of that, then the damage starts to ramp up very, very quickly. So if you get the ideal Emperor hand, you get to hold on to a couple of preps, then things can get messy very, very quickly. And this feels like a deck that will give the Rogue some time to draw through their options.
Fibonacci having some flashbacks of Manatide Totem's past and Deadly Poisoning to take out that one there so that Tides doesn't end up. Tides shaking his head there. Not sure why. He actually has quite a good lineup at the moment.
Yep, Azure Drake, pretty much the perfect option for Rogue, always on turn 5. Might choose to just play out the Harrison for the more competitive stats on board right now. Again, Harrison, no impact on this particular build of Shaman. He can save the Drake for some spell damage later if he needs it that way. He's going to go for the Tomb Pillager instead, which sets up his Auctioneer turn for the following turn if he wants it.
Right, he's hoping to get that coin off that Tomb Pillager. But what's interesting about this Shaman deck is that it does have a lot of answers to Rogue minions through Stormcrack, through lightning bolts, lava shocks, elemental destruction. You've got pretty much all the answers to those 3 and 4 health minions, which is what Rogue has entirely.
Yeah, I think Stormcrack is a card that makes a lot of sense in the meta currently. If you look at what people are playing specifically on ladder, minions like Totem Golem, Fierce Monkey, Frothing Berserker, everything Rogue plays, like Stormcrack is just a card that deals with that so well.
Now, Fibonacci not going to play his Auctioneer just yet. He doesn't know what those cards off the top are going to be, and right now he can't stealth it. He does not run any conceals in his deck, so he needs to make sure that Auctioneer is able to get a number of draws off when it's played, and he doesn't know how many that's going to be just yet. With that Shadow Strike pickup, however, a new card from Whispers of the Old Gods, he's going to be able to deal with this Elise or possibly this Sylvanas.
Yeah, and this Shaman deck is actually looking fairly effective right now. He's curved out with a pretty powerful group of minions, been able to play something on most turns to get some impact on the board. But we are going to see Fibonacci start the Miracle turn here. Does have that sap to answer the Sylvanas. Preparations as well to draw himself even more cards. He will be looking to pull together a potential big burst turn as soon as he possibly can here.
So he preps out that Shadow Strike, that new card from Whispers of the Old Gods. That way he can deal with the Elise. It is a 3-mana card, not a 2. That way he has 2 remaining mana for the sap on the Sylvanas. He picks up a Backstab also, which is going to get him yet another card here from the Auctioneer and help protect his board. He gets rid of the spell damage totem with that so that Lightning Bolts alone or Lightning Storms will not be the ones to deal with it.
Preparation number 2 is drawn, but 2 considerations here. Nothing great in the hand to prep right now, and also this version of Miracle Rogue, your preparations actually have value going into the late game because of the combination with Malagos.
Thing from below and Elemental Destruction going out, locking out the majority of Tide's mana for next turn. He's only going to have 3 available to deal with whatever Fibonacci plays. He is able to use the SI7 agent and his weapon to take out this thing from below. That saves him that Eviscerate, which might have been a little bit of a cleaner kill, a more value-oriented play. But remember, he's got to put together that burst for Malagos later on.
That is a pretty insane draw for Tides right here. With only 3 mana available for his turn, he has managed to kill an Azure Drake and play a 5-5 taunt. That is pretty crazy.
That's not what Fibonacci wants to see there. That spell damage totem, a 1-4 on the last turn, which, or maybe a 1-3, pretty much gave him that kill there. I mean, there wasn't much more he could have done. So interesting play here. He does have some options to take this thing from below out with his other SI7 agent if he can pull a combo together.
So he has 3 burn spells in hand right now. He has a Sinister Strike, he has an Eviscerate, and he has a Shiv. If all 3 of those were discounted, he would draw Malagos for 9 mana and then be able to play a 1 mana spell, the 0 mana Sinister Strike, and have prep for the last remaining spell. So the Emperor is valid at this point, but he's going to choose to use the second Gadgetzan first, which makes a ton of sense. Fill up his hand on even more options before the Emperor comes down.
I believe that's 23 total damage from those 3 cards with Malagos. So
that looks like a good number right now, looking down at the Shaman.
Yeah.
That looks like a good number to be able to do.
Let's see that Malagos come up in a couple more turns here, and he might be so lucky.
Yep.
Oh, Stormcrack off the top. So once again, a guaranteed play here for Tides to kill that Auctioneer, which will prevent that Malagos from coming out sooner. He's going to choose not to take the risk with the Lightning Storm on this play. It's also enable him to put Cairn down on the board, which will pretty much be able to clean up those, again, 4 health and 3 health minions that are so prevalent in the Miracle Rogue list.
Oh, bad news for Savitz. Just as an aside, you can see Dog there. Unfortunate, expected to do very well, especially by Savitz, but he's fallen in the first round, so interesting. Sylvanas comes down here. Attempt number 2 at getting Sylvanas to stick to the board. No sap number 2 in hand for Fibonacci right now, so the Sylvanas is going to start to get some value here, and still no Malagos, but a massive amount of burn built up right now in hand.
There's an interesting option here. He can choose to dagger up, run things into the Sylvanas and Fan of Knives to finish it off.
I like it.
It's pretty good, since you probably want to keep that Blood Mage for your own draw. Now that both Auctioneers are gone, you need to cycle the rest of your deck and get that Malagos before it is too late. I think he might be considering using that fan first, or he might consider just giving him the Blood Mage Thalanos in this case. That does allow him to take out the Storm, Wrath of Air totem as well. He's going to opt for the not giving his opponent minions, probably a bit smarter, but hey. There are some weird plays in Hearthstone sometimes.
There certainly are. And speaking of weird plays, it looks like he is ready to just commit Emperor to this board right now.
He's got
with the Sylvanas in play. He drew the Malygos off the Fan of Knives, so he is now set up a big old pile of damage in his hand. But this is a play that almost gives the board over to the Shaman permanently at this point because of how easy this board state is to deal with. So he is demanding heal from his opponent right this second.
Well, yeah, and it looks like the heal has to come out 100% here. Chill Maw not going to be enough to block damage since all that damage is from spells.
Yep.
So the question here is, of course, most people would see the common play here. Sylvanas running into that 5-5, stealing that 3-3 for you. You get to heal up a little bit, and then even put a Cairn down on the board. I really can't see a much cleaner play than that right now.
Well, here's the thing. He knows the Emperor has just come down. He's seen the Emperor come from the middle of the hand, so he knows what's happened. He knows that Fibonacci will have been waiting to draw Malygos before playing that Emperor. So he now has a read that Malygos is in hand. If he loses Sylvanas from this board, he has no Hex in hand, so he has no way of dealing with Malygos. So I think the consideration there was trying to find a play that let him keep the Sylvanas on board to allow him to mitigate that Malygos.
Looks like he is going to heal up, bringing him out of range, and no more minions left in Fibonacci's deck, so that's a heal for 10. So an additional 3 healing from what it would normally be.
Yep.
And off the top, this is the big card here, Sap. Well, not too helpful. He's going to have to try to establish a board here to get that bit of damage in so that that OTK will work.
Certainly does. Blood Mage coming down. Edwin coming down as well. No interest in sapping that Cairn. He is just going to load up the biggest board he possibly can. Just needs one of these minions essentially to connect with the face, but Elemental Destruction is one of the biggest draws we will see all weekend in game number one.
Well, I don't know how many cards are left in that Tides of Time deck, but that certainly was a very lucky draw. He's going to be able to get this entire board with that Elemental Destruction, and he's going to be forced to do that, knowing that with that Emperor tick, he's facing down at least 20 damage.
Is he forced to use it, though, is the question, because he does have the Lightning Storm and the Lava Shock on top of the spell damage, so he is able to deal with most of this board, if not all of it, while preserving his own board if he'd like to go down that route.
There's a chance, and he might play that Lightning Storm first and then realize, well, I don't have much of a chance outside. But no, not this time. He's going to preserve his Cairn, too, and make sure he hits the face with it, since he's guaranteed to clear everything out.
Yep, generates the Chillmore alongside it by the looks of things. So he is threatening 10 damage right now, has the Lava Shock to back it up. Time is running out for Fibonacci here, does pick up another Shiv. He's going to Shiv the face, and this is a weird position where if we'd have seen Malygos committed to the board at some point this game, it may have ended, but now he picks up Sinister Strike number 2. Malygos, Avis, Avis, Sinister Strike is a potential combination now. Saps the Chillmore. One damage to face goes through, puts him down to 28. This is looking very, very dangerous. I'm not seeing a way out of this for Tides of Time right now.
Right, and there is definitely an OTK there. Heal Azeal not going to be able to bring him up. Malygos with 4 spells is going to give them 20 additional damage, with 8 damage from the Eviscerate and 6 more from the Sinister Strikes. That's it. This game is absolutely over, and it looks like Fibonacci is going to be the one to go on.
Yeah, Fibonacci knows it as well. You can see him just chilling back in his chair. He's like, there's not enough burst in your deck to kill me. You have no way of playing around my hand right now. This game has ended. The interaction has ceased, and you are about to be eliminated, at least from the upper bracket.
Well, looking at Tides of Time here, thinking about best options, should I heal for 2? Should I not heal for 2? He doesn't know that his opponent has a full board here. Looks like he's just going to Lava Shock face, though. Not enough mana, really, to heal for 2, of course. He was locked out for 5, so.
I'm out of cards.
Oh, that's the last card.
Yep.
And that's it.
So yeah, similar situation to the previous series. Tides not can account for every card in the hand, but what he can't account for there is which cards have been hit by Emperor. So it's not the exact same locked up situation that the previous game was, but still, I think he will be fairly confident that he was dead in that situation. So unfortunately, the awesome Shaman deck we're all looking forward to does prove to be the undoing for Tides of Time, and he is going to have to fight this tournament from the lower bracket.
There are a lot of positives to how the deck lists have been revealed, but this might be one of the few times where it worked in someone's, didn't work in someone's favor. Being able to see all those cards remaining in the deck, maybe that tipped off Fibonacci to make game plans early on.
That was a crazy series. I just want to say, if you're not going to have faith in your own Yogg-Saron, why even put it in your deck?
It's crazy, right?
Yeah.
I don't get it.
A couple of interesting, to say the least, decisions in that game. You know, the Freeze Mage against the Freeze Mage.
The aggressive Alexstrasza. Yeah.
I'm mostly talking about the turn where he decided to Defender of Argus up his Ragnarok.
Oh, right. Yeah, got
you. Yeah. And sure. Then, of course, in the last game, Tide's pretty much just condemning himself to death. So. Mm. A little bit interesting, but Fibonacci moving on. And, you know, this is sort of reminiscent of what we saw from the winter preliminary for America, where Fibonacci actually made it to the top eight but wasn't able to go to that championship. So continuing that sort of that really solid play for most of that series.
Yeah, he's an impressive player. Every time I see him, his level of understanding of these control decks, I mean, if you want to call Miracle Rogue a control deck, it is to an extent. It's a very removal-based deck that tries to work through and draw their win condition. But tends to bring these control-based lineups, understands them incredibly well, understands the resource management, life total management, incredibly impressive player.
Yeah.
Got to wonder if in a different universe, those Hearthstone universes where he played that golden monkey, would Tides of Time been able to come ahead?
Or just Yogg.
Just played Yogg. Yeah.
Or Yogg.
A fireball to the face.
Trust Yogg. Yeah, those old gods, they whisper in your ears. Yeah. They're creepy.
Just any spell to the face. But, of course, that's going to be Fibonacci taking it. He's going to move on to the upper bracket. But for now, we are going to send it over to Dan, who's standing by at the prediction board with some updates.
Thank you very much, TJ. We're going to get into our second match very shortly, but we want to also get a check-in with how the brackets are shaping up to be. Now, of course, Tide of Time, I put my faith in him. Clearly, he didn't put his faith in his own Yogg, and of course, I know Brian Kibler, you're pretty disappointed
that. I was sad. I was like, just play it, man. Just play it. Yogg and Monkey, like my two favorite cards. He sat without playing either of them.
And he chose not to. Instead, he chose to just virtually concede there. But how's the rest of the bracket shaping up in the first few rounds here? We saw that Dog, unfortunately, dropped his first round, so that means Savitz is also on the ropes here.
Yeah, a couple of updates as well. Yowitz Flo, one of TJ's picks, he did lose in the first round. A couple other players we are following. The Rat started off with a win, and some other notable players. Hot Form won his first round, but that's Admirable did take a loss.
So definitely some people going through. It's difficult because you see how Fibonacci versus Tides. Like, that's the caliber of tournament they are.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, there's 150-plus players playing in the America's Spring Preliminary, but at the same time, you could run into some of these deadly players that you meet on ladder and tournaments all the time. So definitely keep an eye out on how your favorite players are doing. Even though you're not sure about how it's going to be going into the matchups, you can follow along with us with the brackets on the Twitch page as well as everything else following along the stream. So thanks so much. Everyone's tuned in. We're getting ready for our second match. Make sure to hashtag HCT. Send it over to the caster desk and get ready for our second series of the day.